And a wise man once said that you never truly accomplish anything in your life as long as you're comfortable. So we need to, but just force ourselves a little bit on comfortable.
All right, it seems we have had a very successful student supper and bazaar Wednesday, and a complete report will be available next week. Thank you to everyone who worked, cooked, served, washed dishes, and cleaned. It takes a church to pull off such an event. So, please.
Alicia?
Yes?
If you haven't seen the piece that Nate wrote in the Stafford paper, was that this week? Very good piece, Nate. I hope that gets into our hands some way. But it was very good. You can go to the library and see the paper.
If you could please stand and join me in the call to the reading. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted.
But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength.
They shall mount upon. They shall mount up with wings like eagles.
They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Please join in singing 133, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
Determines the number of the stars
He gives to all of them their needs. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the downtrodden. He casts the wicked to the ground. His delight is not in the strength of a horse, nor his pleasure in the speed of a runner. But the Lord takes pleasure in him who's in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love. Please bow your heads in prayer. O Lord, open my eyes that I may see the needs of others. Open my ears that I may hear their cries. Open my heart so that they need not be without help in their time of distress. Let me not be afraid to defend the weak because of the anger of the strong, nor afraid to defend the poor because of the anger of the rich. Show me where love and hope and faith are needed, and use me to bring them to those places. And so open my eyes and my ears that I may this coming day be able to do some work of peace for you. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's really good to be with you. Many miles have been driven in the last week in my family, and so I want to first begin our time of prayer and sharing your joys and concerns with just sharing this joy that that my family is blessed to have you as a church. And to belong to you, and you belong to us, because your prayers have been felt and appreciated. For those of you who may be not aware, my grandmother, whom I had raised as a prayer request over the last few weeks, passed away on Monday morning, and we had her service on yesterday morning at 10:30 in Leota, and so that has been a good time of sharing, spending time with family. I was not expecting Mom and Dad to be here this week. Dad was coming for a reunion at Sterling College for Friday and some Saturday, and with the funeral, Mom came too. They just drove out. My sister drove out with her family, and we got to see a lot of family from Western Kansas. They will have the burial back in California. They're taking her remains back there to be buried with my grandfather. And so please continue to pray for my family as they travel. My sister made it back to Albuquerque last night, so they're still on their way back to California as well. Mom and Dad are leaving this afternoon, I think. So please keep them in mind as you pray today. Any other joys or concerns today? It was really a fun time.
What was so special is we did you connected with Connor Barnhart.
Yes. And we had been, it's interesting, I had been able to communicate with him in recent weeks about various things, and through Facebook Messenger and stuff, and so I had not had a chance to meet him face to face. And so that was definitely a plus to have that opportunity.
We probably need to remember the people from, Texas through Mexico that were dealing with the strongest hurricane ever on record. And we probably need to remember the people that were killed, or one person was killed, and several injured at a university in a shooting in Tennessee. And probably need to remember the people down in, I believe it was Stillwater, where evidently somebody who was drunk plowed through their homecoming parade and killed, 4 people?
including the baby.
So, unfortunately, there's a lot of not good in this world.
I think we need to remember Tyler Clark and his family, his wife, and his son, Ryder. Ryder is a mental that has very serious health problems. They make quite a few trips to Kansas City Medical Center. So let's keep them in our prayers.
Well, he's a cutie, wasn't he? Any others this morning?
Sorry? I didn't hear you.
Any other prayer requests this morning?
Can we have a group of people on a bus headed for New Orleans? Everyone right into the storm. Safe drivers.
Yeah. Is that a
Aaron and Lynette are going to Houston tomorrow.
Oh, yeah.
Treaty.
Just take your fishing pole there.
Throw the canoe on top. Is that New Orleans trip, is that through the senior center or something?
No, it's through the American State Bank.
No, St. John
National. Oh, St. John
National.
Sorry.
That's what they called. St. John National.
Yeah.
Well, certainly. Just the facts, ma'am.
I'll make it short.
Sybil, nobody will hear a thing if you don't know. Not unless you got a lot louder in a real hurry.
Okay, well, usually soon after, everybody's anxious to know how the fire went. And I think it went well. Everybody enjoyed people coming in. We're just so appreciative and enjoyed the food. We came out with probably $1,874 to the good.
Yes.
And the attendance was pretty much as usual. 138 people came through. And so I think it went well.
Just the facts.
They make it short.
Well, thank you for sharing that. I was curious how many we have. You know, it's when you have kind of a rotating crowd, you know, you kind of lose track of, you know, how many people you have.
I think there were a lot of carryouts in addition to that.
Yeah, that may be. Well, certainly that's a good, that was a successful fundraiser, and we look forward to being able to apply that to our missions.
And I don't know how the gals that make soup seem to come out right at the limit. When they run out of soup, we run out of people.
And however it occurred, the chicken noodle soup turned out great. We had a good report from our sons on that one, so they really enjoyed that. Well, let's go to Lord in prayer, shall we? Father, on this sunny Sunday morning, we gather together to worship you, to offer our thanksgiving and our tithes and ourselves, Lord, for we acknowledge as a group that you are worthy of these sacrifices on our behalf. We love you and we thank you Lord Jesus, for your great compassion expressed toward us on the cross. So, Lord, we wish to lay our concerns and our joys before you. First of all, we want to thank you for honoring our faith and our willingness to set aside some time and energy to have this soup supper and bazaar, particularly thankful for the sugar-free pie that I enjoyed. And Lord, it's just a blessing to be able to have this fellowship, but also turn that thing into a fundraiser to be able to support missions around the world. And we ask, Lord, your blessing on that, those finances, and make them bear fruit in your kingdom, we pray. Lord, for all those who are traveling throughout our country today, not just my family, but also our friends and neighbors who are traveling to New Orleans and traveling to Houston today, we ask, Lord, you would keep them safe and protect them from the weather and trouble that may be on the road. We do not take for granted the violence and the trouble that is in this world, and Lord, too, we just want to lay before you the tragedy at OSU and then in Tennessee. We just ask, Lord, that you would make your name known among the nations of how your people can come around those individuals, the victims in those situations, and be compassionate and show your love and your grace to these people. I pray, Lord, for those in the path of the hurricane, Lord, that they would see it as a demonstration that you could sneeze and a hurricane would come forth, and that you are so great and mighty and powerful. Lord, I pray that people would come to a place where they would find interest in you through this great demonstration of your authority in the earth. Pray, Lord, that you would keep people safe as well in that situation. Lord, we also want to lift up the Tyler Clark family to you, and especially little Ryder. We ask that you would minister to that family. Lord, use us how you may in that, in their relationship or with you, to be an encouragement to them. Show us how we can minister to that young family. And Lord, we pray most of all in all of these things that you would get all the glory. We pray also, Father, for anyone who is not able to be here with us this morning because of sickness or they're gone for the weekend. We just ask, Lord, that you would be with them in their life where they're at today. May they know that you are there. We pray these things in Jesus' name. We also, I would like to invite you to pray with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would you please turn in your hymnals to number 454? Open my eyes that I may see.
Oh, and I desire to hear.
1 through 9 on page 229 of the New Testament in your pew Bible. My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, "Have a seat here, please," while to the other one who is poor you say, "Stand there," or "Sit at my feet," have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgression. Transgressors. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word.
Thanks be to God.
Would you bow with me? And now may the word of my heart and the word of my voice and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Throughout the month of October, we have been exploring the topic of Christian stewardship with the saints. And we first learned about Sarah Crosby, who, because of necessity, was moved by the Holy Spirit to begin preaching at a time in history when women did not assume the role of pastor. Then we discovered how St. Luke the Evangelist emphasized God's generosity in offering salvation to women, the poor, the outcast, and the infirm through the ministry of Jesus Christ. Thirdly, we looked at the way of poverty through the ministry of St. Francis of Assisi. St. Francis introduced us to a heart attitude that God desires, a heart that is humble, compassionate, and self-sacrificing. Today, we examine the life of Mary McLeod Bethune. She was a fascinating Christian woman. She had many older brothers and sisters, most of whom were born into slavery. Yet, as an adult, Bethune was considered a close friend by the incredibly wealthy Eleanor Roosevelt. Bethune was a faithful Methodist who supported the union of the Southern and Northern churches. Yet she voted against the union when segregating black Methodists in their own jurisdiction was included as a compromise measure. The central jurisdiction, sadly, was created over the protest of black Methodists, with the result that the Methodist Church was segregated into the late 1960s. She was the only one in her family to receive a formal education, and she became the president of a college that she founded. She salvaged and repurposed items that others threw away, considering money the least important resource in her work. And yet, she solicited funding from some of the wealthiest Americans of her day. Last week, we talked about St. Francis' approach to just give up on money altogether. Mary McLeod Bethune took a different approach. Give the people the opportunity to financially support a ministry without giving them control over the ministry. Interesting. In fact, she took it a step further. Bethune didn't simply keep givers in their place, refusing gifts with strings attached. She used the relationships she formed with the rich and powerful to put redemptive words in their ears. Bethune's authority was not an inherited status or a position that she bought with money. Instead, she had moral authority. She did not show partiality to one group over another. She enjoyed teaching and spending time with poor black children, fearlessly faced white opponents, and sometimes converted them through loving welcome, and confidently walked into the White House to advise the President and First Lady. She was undaunted by obstacles, but did what was right regardless of who disagreed or who stood in her way, even if it was the KKK trying to stop her from registering black voters in Florida in the 1920s. God is the ultimate authority, and as the psalmist says, his delight is not in the strength of his horse, nor his pleasure in the speed of a runner, but the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love. As Peter says in Acts 10:34, God is no respecter of persons. Bethune's genius was in recognizing God as the only authority. She too was no respecter of persons. In a sense, her moral authority was borrowed from God. People could see that they were on a level playing field with her. Their money, their threats, their power, their status or lack thereof in society were all meaningless to her. And what was meaningful was whether they supported her in her stand for God's vision of justice and inclusion, or if instead they stood against that vision. To what extent do we as a congregation already live in this moral authority borrowed from God? Some rhetorical questions here, something to chew on and think about. Are we steadfastly in pursuit of God's desire? How do we fall short of his goals? How does the Epistle of James in the life of Mary and the life of Mary Bethune inspire us to see the funding of the church's ministries in a new light? Well, let's take a quick look at the Epistle of James, that passage that was read earlier. Some interesting verbs in that passage. And I particularly took words that were in the King James, New International Version, words like favoritism, discriminated, exploiting, slandering, and so forth. I kind of zeroed in on this word discriminated or discriminate. The root of that is criminal. Interesting. And the kind of the idea here is to separate oneself from a person as though you're that person is a criminal and you're a law-abiding citizen. You're looking at this person as though they are an untouchable, as someone who is not worthy of your time, effort, attention, etc., etc. Discriminate, to separate. And then there was a key phrase here, a couple of them. Verse 5. Question. Has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and inherit the kingdom? He promised those who inherit the kingdom that he promised to those who love him. We think of last week and St. Francis and his ministry to the poor and his concern about separating himself from money so that he would live in poverty, and took that kind of countercultural, poor in spirit approach to life. God chose the poor those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith, because they don't have the distractions of what money may or may not be able to buy. And then verse 9, James says, if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. Notice that it's a conditional statement. If you show favoritism, then you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. But going back to that word discriminate, those who discriminate here become lawbreakers themselves. So, at one point, a person is wanting to separate themselves or discriminate against someone else because they don't have any money, and they, in doing so, become lawbreakers, the criminal themselves that they're trying to separate themselves from. Interesting. Now, no matter how much or how little you give to the Lord in this particular church, everyone has equal accessibility to the pastor's office, and I just want to make that point clear today. No one has the authority in this church to, because of how much they give to the church, to tell the church council what it will or won't do because they happen to give so much to the operations fund. The reason why I say that is I have a story I'd like to share with you. I heard a story once about a pastor who spent a good amount of time reaching out and disciplining individuals or discipling individuals and families who happened to have low incomes, but also had many social problems. And so much of that work had to do with dealing with their addictions and the effects of those, marital strife, unemployment. And this ministry took a lot of time, as you can imagine, a lot of energy and effort. Well, at one point, two of the leading church laypersons approached this pastor, concerned that he was spending too much time with people who were not regular givers and not members of the church. And to clarify this point, one of them said in so many words that they aren't the one who are paying for the ministry, for your ministry. Not paying your salary. And so they were trying to manipulate the pastor to do what they wanted because they were the ones who were paying the pastor's salary. An underlying issue here was that they didn't feel that the matriarch of the church, who had incidentally four adult children in the church, grandchildren in the church, who were perfectly capable of ministering to the needs of this widow. They didn't feel the pastor had spent enough time with her. Meanwhile, these people who weren't even members of the church, who could only manage to put a widow's penny in the offering each week, were getting all of the pastor's time in their understanding of it. These two lay leaders came to put a stop to this unfairness. What went wrong here? Overall, they saw their own money and possessions as their own. Let that soak in a second. They missed the part of the Bible that reminds them that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. It's all His. And because they saw the money and possessions that God had given them as their own instead of resources that He gave and expected them to be good stewards of, they didn't think that they were getting their money's worth. Now, I've not been a pastor of this church long enough to know who or if anyone here has behaved in similar ways. I don't know. And I'm not sure that that's the point here today anyway. But rather, Bethune's way of authority and the example that I just gave helped to expose us to some important biblical teachings we perhaps don't look at very often, but have much to teach us. So I say, O Lord, help us, we pray, to be faithful tithers, generous givers and compassionate servants, not because of what we think you or the church might do for us in return. Help us to tithe and give in response to the justifying grace you have already poured out upon us through the sacrifice of our loving Savior. Help us to live thankfully and faithfully. Amen.
Thank you.
healing of Christ. Go forth with the grace of the Holy Spirit. Go forth with the hope of faith.